Right from the stage of early man, human being has expressed his thoughts through so many mediums. Among them, the painting is supposed to be the very first medium of expression of the man's thought.
Namaskara and an heartfelt welcome to all our viewers. Good evening and a warm welcome, ladies and gentlemen. We are all eagerly waiting to have our versatile speaker whose life and soul is research deliberate on the Mysuru traditional painting through his illustrated templates. And DH pays a tribute to this versatile scholar before I introduce him by way of a visual presentation. Thank you. That, ladies and gentlemen, in a nutshell, is the persona of Dr. Maina Sharma. There is an interesting practice that noted Kannada writers write their name with the first syllables of their names. Hence, this well-noted scholar's initials stand for Mysore, Mai, Nagaraja, Na, Sharma. So Maina Sharma is this well-renowned and articulate scholar. A passionate archaeologist, Dr. Sharma goes deep under, unable to resist the smell of Mother Earth and in search of the past human secrets. He is a scientist after discovering he must use the skills of analysis and interpretation to understand the past of artifacts that were used by humans then. Dr. Sharma is a well-known Mysuru traditional painter, an artist trained from the century-old Chamarajendra Technical Institute of Mysore, today rechristened as CAVA, Kava. He is well experienced in both forms of traditional and realistic paintings. Dr. Maina Sharma's research in traditional painting has unearthed new facts, and a press-ready manuscript on the subject is underway. His photographs and paintings have been existed in many national and international exhibitions. Dr. Sharma's diligence in archaeology enabled an astonishing collection of many precious antiques of pottery, paintings, bronzes, writing tools, valuable palm leaf and paper manuscripts. It is an enviable treasure trove. Dr. Sharma has obtained his doctoral degree from the University of Mysuru. He was awarded Wallace Postdoctoral Research Fellowship from Cambridge. He worked in the University of Mysore in various capacities and as the project coordinator of the conservation of manuscripts at the Oriental Research Institute, a heritage building which is more than 100 years old. Dr. Maina Sharma has discovered an unpublished palm leaf manuscript, which was considered as a unique piece of Sanskrit work of the 18th century Kannada work. He is widely traveled and well read. In short, he has developed his abilities in all areas of accomplishment. And again, putting this in a nutshell, and as we had just seen the visual presentation, I can only say that he is an intellectual, artistic, social, physical, and a spiritually imbibed, infused individual. A warm welcome to you, Dr. Maina Sharma. I now hand over the platform to you for the next 60 minutes. We are indeed very thankful for gracing our platform. So welcome, Dr. Maina Sharma.
Namasadase, namasadasaspataye, sarvebhyo mahajanebhyo, मम किञ्चित् शुकभाषणं समर्प्य सादर प्रणामान् सहितं समर्पयामि. कृपया स्वीकरोतु. डियर् लेडीस् एण्ड् जेण्टल्मन्, गुड् मार्निङ्ग्, गुड् आफ्टर्नून् एण्ड् गुड् ईवनिङ्ग् टु. सो हियर् टुडे ऐ हव् बीन् गिवन् द टापिक् आफ् मैसूरु ट्रेडिशनल् पेण्टिङ्ग्. फस्ट्लि, I feel proud to stand on this particular esteemed platform of Destination Heritage, and I feel proud and I thank the president and all the office bearers in general and dynamic lady Dr. Geeta Badikilaya in particular for her coordination with me for this particular assignment, and have spoken about me in such a colorful way. Anyway, I thank you all. Before I start my presentation, I would like to remember and extend my gratitude to all the forefathers who have brought down this particular art to us, and the people, the present artists, contemporary practitioners who are working with this particular Mysore traditional painting and continuing the cart of culture and tradition to the future generation. I salute them all and commence my presentation.
ఎందరో మహానుభావులు అందరికీ నా వందనము. సో లెట్ మీ ప్రెసెంట్ మై స్టార్ట్ విత్ మై స్లైడ్ షో. నౌ డియర్ లేడీస్ అండ్ జెంటిల్మెన్, యాజ్ ఏ అకాడమిక్ రీసెర్చర్ ఐ వుడ్ లైక్ టు డీల్ విత్ దిస్ టాపిక్ ఇన్ త్రీ ఆస్పెక్ట్స్ యాజ్ ఐఎమ్ షోయింగ్ ఇన్ ది స్క్రీన్ ఆన్ ది స్క్రీన్. వన్ ఈస్ పెయింటింగ్ యాజ్ ఎన్ ఆర్ట్ ఫార్మ్ అండ్ ఆరిజిన్ ఆఫ్ మైసూర్ పెయింటింగ్ అండ్ రెనైజాన్స్ ఆఫ్ మైసూర్ పెయింటింగ్. సో నౌ లెట్ అస్ అండర్స్టాండ్ ది ఎఫెక్ట్ ఆఫ్ ఆర్ట్ ఆన్ ది హ్యూమన్ బీయింగ్స్. The art is to create emotions or rasas in human minds. So by looking at some art, some kind of feeling or emotion will be created in our minds. That is the purpose of art. And secondly, the art is a kind of give and take aspect. The artist will create something and it will impart with the listener or viewer and he will enjoy it. Now these are the points. Now the very important purpose of the art, we have different purpose than the purpose what other countries have, that is West has. Now in the Western country, the very purpose of the art is to create a kind of pleasure in the man's mind, but not Indian arts art or in that particular thought. Our purpose is to create a kind of pleasure or satisfaction in the God, not in the human being. We consider the art form as a medium of aradhana, and only two rasas are there in Western art, tragedy and comedy, but we have 9 rasas as per Bharata. Bharata says, Shringara Hasya Karuna Raudra Veera Bhayanakaha Bhibat Sadvata Sanyau Chetyashtau Rasasmrutaha. There are only 8 rasas in Bharata's text, but later on another rasa, that is 9th rasa, Shanta Rasa, was also added. Now we deal with 9 rasas, and we also create different rasas or emotions through our art forms, Indian art forms, maybe drama, maybe painting or maybe sculpture or something. Now in other countries, in Western countries, we find only few forms, but in India every part of our life is, you know, identified as the art form, and that is Chatushashti Kala Vidya. Likewise we have these bifurcations, and in our country in ancient period everyone should be having one or the other kind of arts in himself. That is Sahitya Sangeeta Kala Vihinaha Sakshat Pashuhu Puchha Vishanahinaha Trinanna Khadannapi Jeeva Manaha Tad Bhagadeyam Paramam Pashunam. This Subhashita says that the person who is not versed, well versed with one or the other arts, he will nothing but a beast without having a pair of horn and a tail like. So these are the value given in our literature. Our arts can be bifurcated into two. One is folk art and the other one is classical art. The classical art, the folk art, becomes classical art when it is written in texts, when it is codified, some formulas are made, then onwards it will be considered as classical form. Even in music, even in painting and literature and all have been identified as classical after it is textual form of seeing. Now regard, let us come to the particular form of painting. So regarding painting, we have many ancient Indian literature available in our country. They are Kama Sutra, that's around 4th century CE, and Vishnu Dharmottara Purana, that is 6th to 9th century, scholars define that. And then Manasollasa, a very famous literature about the art of painting and other things. And this Manasollasa is the contribution of a Kannadiga, that is Kannada king Chalukya Vikram Someshwara is the author of this particular text. Here our visual arts are bifurcated into three forms as per our agama. It says trividham pratima karma shastrajna samprachakshate chitram chapya ardha chitram cha chitra bhasan cha kathyate. It means three is common both in English and or Sanskrit. So trividham, three types of pratima karma means visual arts are there. Not me I am telling, but it is said by the Shastrajna Samprachakshate. Chitram is one of the forms, and Chitrardham is the other form, and Chitrabhasa is the other form. Now let us see what are they. As per the agamas, these are the three branches. Now visual arts, the Chitra, let us see, the Chitra is sculptural form of art, and we see three-dimensional object when we look into a statue, or you take for example any object. Even this object is a solid object. It has got length, breadth, depth and all, so many things. So every object on the earth, what we feel is a three-dimensional object. Now, next is, that is Chitra. Now, here we come to Chitrardha. What is this Chitrardha? We have not heard of that very commonly. Chitrardha means an image is there. It has got ups and downs, but just seen from this frontal side, not from the backside. Backside, it is quite flat, but in the front, you will see a lot of ups and downs by creating an image. I'll just show you that shortly. Now, another one is, the third one is Chitrabhasa. In Sanskrit, Abhasa means it is appeared one, it is seen, it is felt or it is experienced. Abhasa means visually seen, not physically touched. So the third one is painting. My friends, in our traditional books, we do not directly consider Chitra into only painting. We also mean Chitra into three forms. That is Chitra sculpture, and also the relief is also Chitra, but Ardha Chitra. And then Abhasa, Chitra Bhasa is the painting one. What you are seeing just behind me is Chitra Bhasa. Now, let us see the example.
Chitram Vatataror Mule Vribdha Shishya Gurur Yuva Gurostu Maunam Vyakhyanam Shishyastu Chinna Samshayah.
Here, in this particular shloka, so far, we have not very seriously thought of the word Chitra. I have gone to the Sanskrit texts and found a wonderful shlokam by Shankaracharya, which gives the exact meaning of Chitra. Here, what that shloka says, as you have heard, Chitram Vatataror Mule Vruddha Shishya Yuva Guru. That means, Chitram means, wow, wonderful, awesome. This expression is meant as Chitra, not any object. Chitra means it's a kind of emotion, Adbhuta Rasa. By looking at the Vatavruksha, that is the pupil tree, there under the Vruksha, the Dakshinamurti is sitting. How is he? He is not an aged person. He is very young with budding mustache. He is there and he is just about 16 years or 15 years. He is the guru sitting there. But the disciples, who are they? They are all Vruddha Shishya. That means they are all quite aged, white-haired people. They are discussing among themselves. But this guru is just parting with the great knowledge without any word or opening his mouth. Simply, he sits in Chin Mudra and he passes the silent messages to the rishis, who are quite grown up and quite old. Is this not a wonder? We have not come across such activity on the earth. What we are seeing there under the Vatavruksha Dakshinamurti is doing by Shankaracharya, it is said, Gurostu Maunam Vyakhyanam Shishyastu Chinna Samshayah. This is really a wonderful thing. So the real meaning of Chitra, not even the sculpture, not even the relief, not even the painting, but the effect of Chitra is something called Adbhuta Rasa. Now let us see the very first form of Chitra as per the Agama, that is sculpture. This is an image made by me about 30 years ago. It is Australopithecus, and archaeologically a specimen, and he was there about 10 lakh years ago, and that is the transitional stage from ape to man-like. So I have made a small reference image, and by looking at it, I am just making the other bigger one. You can see that image from all around like any other statue. This is the Chitra, that is sculpture. The next one is relief. This is made up of fiber, and this is supposed to be the biggest hero stone in Karnataka. I made this about 20 years ago. And now the third form is called Chitra Bhasa. Here, why it is called Abhasa? Here, actually, these two objects, what you are seeing, you can just feel it and you can touch it and you can experience its ups and downs. But here in this particular painting or the form of painting, you do not see any ups and down. Just by seeing, you can see, you can feel it, you can experience it. But while touching it, you will not be able to see the ups and downs. It is nothing but a kind of illusion. It is a kind of maya. That's why it is only felt but not experienced like. So it has been given the name of Chitra Bhasa. So sculpture and relief and painting. These are the three forms of visual arts in Indian art field. So that is expressed in importance of painting. Now let us see. Kalanam pravaram chitram dharma kamartha mokshadam Mangalyam Prathamam Chitram Chaitad Grihe Pratishthitam. This shloka says every home should be adorned with one or the other God's image. Then that is the purpose of Mangala Parisara. So one has to have in his house some paintings. The importance of painting I am just speaking about. Yatha Sumeru Pravaro Naganam Tathandajanam Garuda Pradhanaha Tatha Naranam Pravaro Kshitishaha Tatha Kalanam Iva Chitrakalpaha. What a beautiful shloka it says. Sumeru is the mountain. How among the mountains the Sumeru is great, and Yathandajanam Garuda Pradhanaha, how Andaja means bird which lays eggs. Lo, we in Sanskrit we call egg layer likewise. Andaja. So Andajanam Garuda Pradhanaha. Garuda is the great among the birds, and Yatha Naranam Pravarosh Kshitishaha. Naranam, that is among human beings. Pravaraha is the important or the first man or the person is, that is Kshitishaha is king. Kshiti means earth. Tatha kalanamiva chitrakalpaha. Likewise, among all the arts, chitrakala is the important one, he says. Now let us jump to the actual form of paintings. There are so many types of paintings we have come across in our history. That is rock paintings in the caves during the early man stage. Then after the classical age, we see the wall paintings. This is also a kind of wall, but it is an unprepared raw wall. But here it is prepared with lime wash and other things. The surface is prepared called fresco, secco and all. So this is a kind of wall painting or bhitti. Anyway, this is another form that is called cloth, painting on cloth called patachitra. And this is palm leaf images. We have come across a number of palm leaves on which the painting or illustration has been done. And this is another paper manuscript. Paper manuscript is very popular in our Karnataka. And on the paper manuscript, we have some illustrations. It's a beautiful painted illustration. It is in my collection. And these are the wrappers or the cover or jackets of the manuscript. And they are also covered. And these are the household articles like objects. And that is also painted. So these are the places where we find painting. Now let us jump to the very early paintings in Karnataka or in India itself. That classical painting starts from the Ajanta. So in Ajanta, you see the wall is prepared and on that people have painted. In right from 2nd century to 7th century, Ajanta paintings run actually. You can see the beautiful work in all these places. And as already Dr. Geeta has said that there are so many forms of art, regional arts. This is especially when we are speaking about Mysore traditional painting is the regional art. So regional arts are so many in India, that is from Madhumani and Dakhani style and Kalamkari style. And these are the style Maharashtra and Tanjavur and Mysore. Now our concentration is only on this particular Mysore. If at all time permits, we will discuss about Tanjavur as well. Now the painting came onto the walls. See, this is a kind of work. It's photographed by me of Somanathpura temple. You can see this not wall. This is the ceiling of Bhuvaneshwari, called Bhuvaneshwari. This is in Somanathpuram around 12th century. Friends, this is not a wall. This is also a ceiling substituting this beauty into this one. See, during the period of Hoysalas, they were carving such beautiful, in-depth, three-dimensional ceilings. But during the period of Vijayanagar, we have lost that beauty or we have lost that capacity of doing this kind of art. We have converted these chitras or adbhutas into only painting. This is not wall. This is ceiling on the one mantapa of Vijayanagara period, that is in the Krishnadevarayas period it was built, and that is decorated. Now my point here is this kind of beautiful decorative ceilings were substituted with this kind of plain chitra bhasa. If a visually impaired person touches this, he will never feel any kind of image there. He says, why you are fooling me with a paintless or imageless paper, sir? Kali paper hai wo, or you are just fooling me like. But here, even a person who is not having eye can also feel that. That's why that is called Chitrabhasa or Chitrartha. Now, the method of painting, this is our previous CE, 8th century CE. This is from Pattadakallu. And this is Vijayanagara, the same what I shown you. So this is painted on ceiling, a very huge painting. It's wonderful, no doubt. But when compared to this, this is something different. Here, I am just showing you this to see how they have translated real life into visuals. Even in 8th century and even in Harappa Mohenjo-daro, we have come across this kind of technology. Here, they have followed certain things. Very firstly, they have made the important object to be focused. That is, emphasis they have given by making the object bigger than all the other objects. Secondly, they have placed this object in the center of the frame. When we look at this picture, we do not see anything else ever. Our eye will move, push to this particular spot. Hence, it is, since this is an important element or the main object, it is placed in the center. And these are all the objects, secondary objects, which is supporting the incident and narrates the story. They are all carved in a little way. Secondly, the frontal person, when we look into a real life in nature, friends, the nearest point, one person is standing, the distant one, next one, next one, next one, next one. They are all placed on the earth horizontally. But here, the painting is a vertical one. We do not see any horizontal effect there. And hence, they have done this. Frontal person is there. And just backward person is lifted a little more. Behind him, he will be lifted a little more. And behind him, he will be lifted further. That's why you should assume all these actors are one behind the other. And among them, in the center, the Surya is there. This is the image of Surya. This is called the emphasizing technique of Indian or most of the other places also you find. This is the technique. Now, the themes for the same Girija Kalyana I'm showing. This is Girija Kalyana on the ceiling of Hampi. This is the three-dimensional, this is Chitra Ardha, not totally three-dimensional, Ardha Chitra. See how beautiful this particular Girija Kalyana image is carved before this particular era. And in this particular era, the same thing is carved, painted on the wall to two-dimension. Now, some more examples what we have come across in Lepakshi. This is just after the Vijayanagara paintings, and this is also one of the beautiful evidences what we have. Now we will come to Karnataka. In Karnataka, this painting is situated in one of the mathas, Jaina mathas in Shravanabelagola, and we can see the remains. These are painted during the period of Mummudi Krishnaraja Vadiyar, which was the climax, as Dr. Geeta said. Now, some more other interesting places where we have come across the Mysore traditional painting, Hampi, Lepakshi, Sira, CB and Srirangapatana and Haradanahalli, Mysore, and all these places, we see the images of Mysore traditional painting, remains of Mysore traditional painting. Now, friends, I would like to deal with one particular research point. People say, we have got very few books in our, availability at our reach. And those books say, and the artists are also say like this, the very originally, the Mysore traditional painting was originated in Vijayanagara. Then it came to Mysore during the period of Mummudi Krishnaraja Vadiyar and where it got its climax. So here it is a bit confusing if we put in that way. We should understand that the gap between the fall of Vijayanagara and also the rise of Mysore or the Mummudi's period exactly to be precise with. So this took place around 1650. So the Vijayanagara vanished, then the Mysore Raja came in 1800 AD. So there was a gap of 150 years nearly. What happened to this Mysore traditional painting? Where these artists were hiding? So these are the questions to be answered. It should be put in proper way. Vijayanagara was there before 1650. It was just the identity of Vijayanagara. But during this Vijayanagara period, before this 1336 to 1650, in between this period, Mysore was there, Tanjore was there, and Andhra was there. They were all parts of Vijayanagara, and the artists were scattered in all these places. But what happened to Vijayanagara's perishing time? Then the cream of the artists who were sitting in the Vijayanagara, Hampi, near Hampi, so they scattered and they went through all the places around, not only to the south, they even go up to the north, that is to Maharashtra and also towards Andhra. My friends, I would like to emphasize one point. Here, the Mysore king was not there in Mysore. During this particular 1650, as per our books and scholars say, 1650, it came to Mysore. Friends, in 1650, Mysore was a negligible place. It was a very ordinary, very common a village-like place. There was no king at all in Mysore during this period. Because before that, in the 1610, the king comes up and sits in Srirangapatana's throne. Because Srirangapatana was a bigger identity than Mysore. So today Mysore may be bigger and Srirangapatana is a smaller one. But that day, around 1650, the Mysore was very big. The very first Raja of Mysore, Vadayar, in Srirangapatana was in 1610, that is Raja Vadayar. So when 1610, before the fall of Vijayanagar, there was a king in Srirangapatana who hails from Mysore. So he was ruling from Srirangapatana and a vast place called as Mysore Kingdom, not Mysore City. We should understand, people have got a lot of confusion among this. Mysore is an identity, different place, which is sitting here for your reference. Then here, this Mysore Kingdom is ruling a very big area, and this area is called Mysore Kingdom. So these Vijayanagara people just scattered and came to this Mysore Kingdom and found a place in many places. But the cream of them came to the Srirangapatana, not to Mysore. So in Srirangapatana, they were there till the death of Tipu Sultan. As Dr. Geeta said, so they came to Srirangapatana first. They were there. And there we have different periods. Let us see this in full screen, Mr. Rao. So this particular portion is the Srirangapatana. They directly come to Srirangapatana. Then what happened in the middle? Afterwards, these Vadayars rule will face a kind of eclipse due to this Hyder Ali and Tipu Sultan. So for this particular few decades, there was no kings. But what happened to the Mysore traditional painting? It was not yet called as Mysore traditional painting. It was just traditional painting. So it was patterned by, in the same way, which was patterned by Vadayars. Tipu Sultan and Hyder Ali were also patterned this particular art. They have decorated their particular palace and other places with high quality of the same painting continuation. But they, instead of creating Hindu gods and goddesses, they have utilized that for decoration of the buildings. But meanwhile, the Hindu rich men and other mathas and Rama Mandiras, there the people were used to paint Mysore traditional painting for the purpose of Hindu deities and stories. Now let us come to the final stage. This takes place in 1800. 1799, this Raja was after all 5 years child. He sits there. Even next year, 1800, this is not the image of that person of this particular period. So in 1800, he could not even pattern the whole Mysore traditional artist or any other form. Later, when he became around 20, 25 and he became the real ruler, then he starts. Friends, this is my painting. I have made this for a five-star hotel in Bangalore, that is in Hotel Gardenia in Rajaram Mohan Roy Circle. They have purchased a number of paintings and photographs and they have displayed there. This is one of the paintings what I did for them. Anyway, this is their requirement and I did it. I call this into three phases. Mysore traditional painting, particularly Mysore traditional painting, has three phases. One is pre-Tipu Sultan. And another one is during Tipu Sultan. The final one is post-Tipu Sultan. So post-Tipu Sultan comes to Mumbai, but let us see the and we have not come across a number of, this remains of this Tipu Sultan's previous period. And most of the houses are demolished and the Rama Mandira and temples are demolished. And we don't come across a number of evidences there. But still during the period of Tipu Sultan, you can see the beautifully decorated palace of Tipu Sultan, that is Darya Daulat. These are the pictures. You can see every particular corner or every inch is painted with beautifully decorated and colorful images. And even this is the Tipu Sultan. He is moving on a howdah and on an elephant. See, this howdah is also used by Mumbai Krishnaraja Vadayar just after the fall of Tipu Sultan. I will just show you some of the pictures. So these are the paintings we see in the Tipu Sultan's Darya Daula. See, today Mysore painting, almost this particular kind of transitional period has influenced a lot of today's Mysore traditional painting in its colors and in its architecture and in its costume and in all the respects it has affected. This is one of the walls of the Tipu Sultan's palace, Darya Daulat. Now, this is the hero of our Mysore traditional painting, what we are speaking of. This is Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar in his middle days, almost later days. And this is also a painting done by me. This is also done for that, prepared for that particular five-star hotel, that is Hotel Gardenia. And this is an ancient work. This is around and almost contemporary to this particular Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar. And this is not created by me. The traditional means you have to follow all the rules and regulations and patterns of the forefathers. That's why it is called heritage or even tradition. Now here, this is Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar's contemporary painting. Anyway, I've got another 20 minutes of explanation. If you feel like, I'll just wind it up any minute. So this is Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar's, the Agita told, the biggest possible painting available of Mysore traditional painting is of Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar. This is about 7 feet high. It is placed in the Vadaiyar's Museum in Mysore. I don't know whether it's opened or closed. This is the original painting. This is a replica made by me. I have copied this painting and made a replica of this particular. Now we will have a look at this. See, Mysore painting, friends, has got some difference between regular painting and Mysore painting and also Tanjore painting. Now this is the very first phase of drawing the image. This is called outline, or in Sanskrit it is matrika. After that, the originally Mysore painting has got three different stages or evolution. Very first paintings, I will just show you, they are not having anything else other than the painting. Anything other than the painting. They are only painting. But later days, they have developed a kind of rising, embossing, or comes a kind of ups and downs there in the picture. And also they have added gold, embedded gold. It is gilded with gold. So now we have got three different stages. One is drawing I'm making. Then I'm applying a color of yellow to identify the places where the gold comes. Next, this is the finally prepared painting. So here we also have come across all the three types. I'll just show you. These are not those three types. This is single painting, but three different stages. Now let us have a closer look of this.
Kayo Shri Gauri Karuna Lahari Toya Jakshi Shankarishwari Kayo Shri Gauri Karuna Lahari Jachi Shankarishwari.
Friends, it took me one full month to paint this. So when we look at the painting, we will not be able to understand that how big it is. So when we compare that with some human beings, it will be possible for us to understand. I'll show you some more pictures. See, this is a picture of this same Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar. On the day of Vijayadashmi, this is the elephant Jambu Savari going on. And this is the howdah, what I told you. Originally, this was of Tipu Sultan, and you can see the stripes of tiger there. So later on, when the Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar will see that the present howdah is prepared. And see, this is the almost the earlier processions of Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar of Dasara. This is a British officer, and these are all the people, and this is a picture. I have exposed this in London. This is preserved in Albert Victoria Museum during my visit. I especially took permission and saw the whole lot. This is the roll. It is a 30 feet lengthy roll by 2 feet of width. It has got very beautiful images there of the whole lot of professional tableau and other things. See, this is a painting of the same situation painted in Mysore Jaganmohan Palace. You may please even pay a visit to that place. And this is on the third floor of that particular palace, Jaganmohan Palace. This is the Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar not going on an elephant during the Vijayadashmi procession. He is seated in a cart pulled by the elephants. And here, it was not the elephants or howdah or Maharaja place in the whole procession at the end, but it was in the beginning itself, those days. Now let us come to some paper manuscript. This is purely of Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar's period. This is about 1830 or somewhere here and there. And this is the paper manuscript. we have got a very beautifully illustrated text called Sri Tattva Nidhi. It is of 9 different volumes, Vishnu Nidhi, Shiva Nidhi, Bhuta Nidhi, there are so many Nidhis, and these are the paintings and these are the texts. It is a text written on the forms of devatas and rituals on that particular devatas. So here the artist will paint something related or illustrate something and the space will be left. Then the scholar will write the particular shloka or the explanation about that. Mysore, I was working in Mysore Oriental Research Institute, and our department or university is bringing up all the nidhis one by one after the other, and that is Shiva Nidhi, Vishnu Nidhi, Shakti Nidhi or something like that. But fortunately, I was there among this complete editorial. I was there in the editorial board during that period, and I find contentment in having my association with this particular thing. Now, friends, we will come to a very, very important and the finest of Mysore tradition, example of Mysore traditional artwork. This is situated in Bangalore's Chitra Kala Parishad. If you happen to go there, kindly have a look at this and you please enjoy the real beauty of this. This is about 3 feet or so, and one cannot imagine the beauty what imbibed in it by this. See, this is a close-up. See, these are the images. This is Brahma here, Vishnu here. This is Vishnu Vishwarupa. This is Virat Rupa. This is Shiva here sitting with his consort. You can see, friends, I have seen images with this size, a nail-sized image I have seen there. And some of the images, see how beautifully it is outlined. Actually, the outline is most important aspect since it is called Matrika. And without proper outline, your finished painting will never be perfect. Nowadays, unfortunately, the Mysore traditional practicing people, not the professionals, the amateurs, they do not bother about practicing the outline. They straight away go for painting. Their painting will be not as good as the professional work. And hence, now, see, these are the other parts of this particular. Unfortunately, we have only the portion of it. It is not in toto. See, there is a deer and child. Highly intricate work is done on this particular painting. This is the supreme most available remain of the Mysore traditional painting. Now, these are also like Sri Tattva Nidhi. This is another example. This is in my collection. I have collected this. This is during the period of Mumbai 1850, and they have illustrated with beautiful images in this particular text. My friends, as I told you, this is the original Mysore painting. This painting is only a painting. That is Chitra Abhasa. If a blind person touches that, as I told you, he will never feel that there is a painting or something. It must be a beautiful, real painting, form of painting. Now here, what we see, a kind of improvement with the influence of Tanjore painting. In Mysore also, we have got that kind of taste or trend towards this. You see only the effect of the gold is painted with yellow and different shades of yellow. We call yellow ochre and burnt sienna and golden yellow and lemon yellow. These are the yellow shades we use to create golden effect on a paper. But here, the real gold itself is stuck or embedded or gilded. When you stick the real gold on the painting will lose its beauty at all. Likewise, I call personally a kind of deterioration starts in this period. So real painting will be converted to a craftsman work-like. So now we will proceed. Now, these are some images of a single theme. Let us see the Krishna along with the Gopikas, he is there. And different kind of artists, different artists depict is in their own way. So here, every painting should carry a shloka from the Agama or the Purana to introduce or illustrate, to explain about this. So here, this Gopala is ended with Hyashtastri Pariveshtito Vijayate Gopala Chudamanihi. Like Hyashtastri, 8 girls are there around him, Gopikas. The 8 girls are not the real girls, they are Siddhis, they are the qualities.
Krishna ni begane baro, Krishna ni begane baro, Krishna ni begane.
This painting, I have it in my collection. I painted it. And there also, I have stick to the Mysore style of painting by adding gold and embossing it and all. See, this is one of the examples of our Mysore pure traditional painting. We don't come across any gold or embossing or something like that. So this is a beautiful image of Krishna. Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadayar, during his period, he was fond of Krishna images. And most of the artists, to please the Vadayar, they used to write Krishna in so many different poses. That is, illustrates the Puranic stories and all. Here, our Krishna is playing a chess. Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadayar was also very fond of chess. I'm going to show you some of the pictures made by me about Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadayar playing chess. And here, the Krishna, Krishna is always a Lola. And he is a tomboy. So the Krishna in this painting, artist has depicted him as Savyasachi. I call him as Savyasachi. Arjuna is called as Savyasachi because he shoots bow and arrow in both hands. I can use both right hand or left hand. Likewise, the Krishna can play chess in both hands. To speak in a lighter version, he is playing, he is keeping his hand, right hand on the chessboard, and he is playing in his left hand on the chessboard of the Gopika, one of the Gopikas. So this is the glamorous aspect expressed through the Krishna's image. We have got a number of images where Krishna will never simply sit quiet. Here, in this particular art painting, the Krishna is playing pagade, or a kind of board game with Gopika, with Rukmini or any other his partners. So here, please understand, Mysore traditional painting originally is a kind of folk art, not the classical art. Classical art means that it has got realistic resemblances. It leans towards resemblances. But here, folk-like, you see, when two people are playing pagade or some board, you never see that in a vertical fashion. You will see it in a horizontal fashion. But here, in real Mysore traditional painting, our concept is something different. So this person is standing in front of the in the forefront, but still this image is bigger and this image is smaller. We have overcome the perspective. We call in art as perspective. And this is another a painting by me, and Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadayar is playing the same kind of chess. This is with gold and embossing all that. So the original image was painted by one Mr. Srihari, a traditional painter who is living in T. Narsipur. He has contributed a lot. He is the only traditional painting, in my opinion, in today's arena. And these are the two images which we come across in Mysore painting, traditional painting. Very old painting this is. This is about 1850 or something around that, and 19th century it is. See here, the very famous part here is the Rati and Manmatha. They are playing games. Actually, they are playing game of love. There is a lot of stories and the slokas depicting these two characters. My point here is to explain you that she is sitting on an elephant and he is sitting on a horse. But my friends, this elephant is not an elephant. Here, nine ladies are seen in different postures and they appear to be elephant-like. So this painting in Mysore traditional painting is called Navanari Kunjara. Kunjara means elephant. So Navanari is imbibed into a form into a elephant. And here this is also not the horse, but it is Panchanari Turaga. Five ladies are there and they are forming into a horse-like. So these two are very famous images available in many places of Mysore traditional painting. My friends, let me jump. Geeta ji, shall I continue for another 10-15 minutes? Hello, Mr. Rao. Shall I continue for another 10-15 minutes?
Yes, please continue. Sure.
It's getting late. So this is, I'm going switching over to the image of Ananta Padmanabha. This Ananta Padmanabha image we have found in Mahabalipuram around the 7th century. So this is about 400 years old sculpture situated in Mahabalipuram. Now, this somebody just asked me, Ranganatha is good or something like that, they said, but this is not Ranganatha. Ranganatha is having a different kind of posture. He is just sleeping on the bed of Naga, by keeping his hand under the head or something like as a pillow. But here, this is a very rare. People look at this. They do not observe the important point depicted in this. That is, this particular Ananta Shayana Vishnu is not just a Vishnu. I had expressed my opinion regarding the Padmanabhapuram talk one day that princess presented there. Then I told, this is not just the Vishnu. We see all the Trimurtis there in this picture. And this is a combination of Trimurti, Samyukta, Chitra, and where the Trimurtis combine, and that becomes the Parabrahma concept. So this is nothing but Parabrahman represented it all the three. Here Brahma, you may all know that. And this is Vishnu. But you will see his hand is dragging our vision towards a lingam here in representing the Shiva. So this hand is placing the Bilva Patra on this particular lingam. And hence this is a very, very important image in Mysore traditional painting. And this is situated, available in the Sri Tattva Nidhi, what we have in our Oriental Research Institute. After this painting, I made a replica of this myself. This is my painting. So let it be shown in the full screen. Yes, lovely. You can see the grandeur of that Ananta Padmanabha. But as I told you, this is not a realistic image. I will show you the realistic image made by me as well. Here you see the legs, how he has placed. My friends, I would like to tell you one particular point regarding Mysore traditional painting. We paint realistic paint in one hand and the stylized paint in one hand. I call the Mysore traditional painting as a stylized one. What is the meaning of stylized one? What is the meaning of realistic paint? I have to take the measurement and translate it to the canvas. So that is a kind of work where you will see the exact replica of the particular person. That is called the realistic art. A replica of the particular object. Then you will see the real apple is placed there. You will feel it as real apple. So that is realistic art. But here in Mysore traditional painting, we are not doing so. Simply close his eyes instead of opening it. He will look into his own canvas as per the description made by the scholars or the Digdantis or Drashtaras. The scholars, the text they written by the rishis, no? They write how the Vishnu or Ananta Padmanabha is seen is written in a text form. So this text form, he will read it. And he will close his eyes and he will look into his own canvas and he will visualize it to us. So, in my opinion, this artist is not a creator. The creator is the original Rishi who experienced, who saw the Markandeya Rishi, saw the Gopa Krishna on the this Alada, Vatavrikshasya Patra Opari, Saha. Upavishati, Atva Malkontane, he is there in Shayana posture. Likewise, please understand, the Rishi visualizes himself and brings it to the text. So the artist will look at the text and closes his eyes and he imagines that narration and he brings it onto the canvas. So that is the creator and this is the visualizer. Likewise, you can see while closing the eyes and seeing it and coming back onto the canvas, you may not be able to see exact human replica there. And secondly, it is prohibited in traditional painting to copy the human image exactly onto the canvas and make a copy of that human being. He is very, very a smaller identity when compared with the God's identity. And hence it's a big theory. Now, I'm showing you this picture by holding it in my hand so that you will be able to see. This was exposed yesterday. That is 15. And you can see this picture. Why I am showing you with me is we in archaeology to show any object. You are not able to understand how big this painting is. You might have assumed that it is of this size, 10 inches or 12 inches, or maybe of 5 feet or 6 feet. But when you compare a picture or an object with the human beings, that's called a human scale in archaeology. So you will be able to see the exact size or magnitude of the picture. Now here, very famous, another popular theme in Mysore traditional painting is Yashoda Krishna. The Yashoda Krishna, right from 1850 to modern Ravi Verma, and even after that, it is being continued. This is such a beautiful image, and it's a concept. Now, this is my painting, friends. I have made this. I'm just showing you the size now. Another famous painting of Mysore style, which you can see it almost all the houses, traditional houses. This is called Raja Rajeshwari or Tripura Sundari. This is one of the favorite deities of Vadaiyars too. And the last Jayachamaraja Vadaiyar Bahadur of Mysore King's wife, whom I have taken a number of photographs, and her name was Tripura Sundaramani. So this is called Rajeshwari or Tripura Sundari.
Tripura Sundari, Tripura Sundari, Shankari Tripura Sundari, Shankari Tripura Sundari, Shankari Guru Gurjanani Mamava Tripura Sundari.
This is a wonderful image. And this is painted by me. I'm sorry, I did not tell you. I tell you that particular Rajarajeshwari is painted by me. You can see my identity there. Now, let us see some traditional houses in Mysore. This particular home, whenever you pay a visit to Mysore, you must pay a visit to this particular house situated in Mandi Mohalla, very famous as Savai Ranganna's house. So the Savai Ranganna family, it has got nearly 50 Mysore traditional painting which are worth crores of rupees, but they have not sold them out, made money, but they are still living in a very, very simple way of life. These paintings were done by her grandmother's period, and this grandmother was about to go to Varanasi, Kashi, but she could not go, and hence the money what was saved for Varanasi's visit, she just paid it to the artist and got painted the whole. I have got 10 avatars. All of them are here and I have taken photograph of them. I am having it with me now. I have taken a reference from many pictures of this particular house. This is another picture. You see the paintings behind on the wall. This is a house situated in Srirang and Nanjanagodo. This is the Dikshit's house, and they have very, very huge paintings in their house. If you happen to go to Nanjanagodo, around the temple itself, you see so many houses. Now let us jump to. So this is, yeah, this is myself and my studio. And these are all the paintings I am doing. This is how I use to draw and paint. So this is the same thing. And we do also a kind of embossing on the paper first, on the outline first. Then the embossing will be colored with basic colors. And then finally, we will paint the final paint and we will also apply the gold on that. So this is a beautiful image of Venkatesha. And this is the first stage of embossing, raising it from the paper. And this is, dear Geetaji, whenever you want me to stop, you kindly inform me, remind me so that I can wind it up within a couple of minutes, please. So because the time is already over. And this is the finished work. Now let us see. Now you can see the size of this picture. It's not about 6 inches or 6 feet. It is about 4 feet or something like that.
कौसल्या सुप्रजा राम पूर्वा संध्या प्रवर्तते उत्तिष्ठ नरशार्दूल कर्तव्यं दैवमान्धिकम् कौसल्या सुप्रजा राम पूर्वा संध्या प्रवर्तते उत्तिष्ठ नरशार्दूल कर्तव्यं दैवमान्धिकम्।
Now, this is also another form of Venkatesha, that is Srinivasa. It's also my work. I'm just showing you most of my works here. And let us see.
Kalyana Kruta Gatraya Kamitaka Pradarine Srimad Venkatanathaya Srinivasaya Te Namaha.
This is the sloka what we also write sometimes below the image. And now my friends, I have come across a small piece of Yashoda Krishna. I am holding it in my palm. You just see, it is not ordinary paper. It is a ivory sheet. It is not in my collection. I saw it somewhere. And such a small, micro, tiny work. You can see the beautiful Yashoda Krishna in our traditional form. This is my work. I am showing you just a close-up of how the face is drawn. This is Devi. It can be any Devi. And this is painted by me. My friends, I had told you about the realistic painting. These are all my paintings. Again, I am telling you, repeating. And these are all the paintings. By looking at, you can identify the person. This is Mr. Rajiv Gandhi. And this is Mr. Vivekananda, Swamiji Vivekananda. And this is, you may not be able to recognize it very quickly. This is the kingmaker or the great Purnaya of Mysore kingdom, who served the three kings, Hyder Ali, Tipu Sultan, and also Mummadi Krishnaraja Vadaiyar. He's a great person. So this is a painting made by me about 5 feet, 4.5 feet. That is also for Hotel Gardenia in Bangalore. This is the realistic art. And here, my friends, did not we recognize the image of Hanumanta or Rama in former pictures or Tripura Sundari? What is the speciality in this? We are recognizing Rajiv Gandhi here and Swamiji here. And there also we recognized Rama. No. There we did not recognize Rama because of their face. Their face was identical to Rama and Krishna or Ananta Shayana. Everybody identical. But only their costume and the properties what they were holding, they were all different and characteristic features to depict that particular person. So that is not realistic art. That is a stylized art. So there you will be able to understand Rama or Krishna by their properties, by their costumes. But here, even if you change the costume, the face will disclose the person's identity. That's why it is called realistic art. I am practicing both kind of them because I came up in this particular field with my tradition, regular realistic art only. Then I just also adopted my traditional painting seriously. And my friends, we are coming almost to an end. I am happy. So this is one of my recent exhibitions held in Bangalore year 2020, about 6 months ago this took place. So I was handling a class there and it was very, very popular in Mysore those days. And these are the students who are coming to me, and these are the faculty, and this how we prepare the embossing paste. We mix up chalk powder and other things and we grind it to fine grained milk like thing, and this is called the embossing paste. And here how there was no, see, this is exposed in 2007, my friends. There was no corona those days, but I was wearing this kind of mask there then, because when we apply the gold leaf is such a tiny, unimaginable thin sheet of gold. So only the gold on the earth has got capacity to become so thin, lesser than the onion skin. So when you apply that onto this particular painting, your breathing may cause damage or movement in that particular thing. So when we work, we don't switch on the fan, no air conditioner, and no windows are open, and we simply don't even open our mouth and we do work. But this was an occasion where I had to explain to my students, so I had to open my mouth and speak. My speech may cause some breathing disturbance to the golden lens. I was wearing this. I'm just explaining you the delicacy of the
Shuddha Brahma Parat Pararam Kalatmaka Parameshwara Ram
शुद्ध ब्रह्म परात् परराम कालात्मक परमेश्वर राम शेषतल्प सुख निद्रित राम ब्रह्माद्यमर प्रार्थित राम चंड किरण कुल मंडन राम श्रीमद दशरथ नंदन राम कौसल्या सुखवर्धन राम.
सो फ्रेंड्स, राम पट्टाभिषेक is the contentment of our life and arts. Now let me conclude this. And anyway, if at all you have had some pleasure or some kind of entertainment, it is my contentment. And I thank you all, the viewers, and also the Destination Heritage for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you so much, Dr. Nagara Sharma. Adbhutavagitu. That is the only best term that I can use in Kannada. My vocabulary is very limited, but I would say it is awesome. It was a richly illustrated talk with the music and emotionally charged when we heard the national anthem of the erstwhile Mysore Kingdom. It was a thoroughly thought-provoking presentation, and we have not been moving due to the coronas in the last 10 months. So today we had the good fortune of sitting in the comfort of our home and watching a movie. It was a movie of 1.5 hours, which we thoroughly enjoyed. There was a scholarly talk, there was a visual representation, there was music. And why this talk is very, very brilliant is because the speaker is not only an artist, but he is a scholar. Usually you will find either the talk will be scholarly loaded or it will be artistically very beautiful. But in this case, he is both an artist as well as a scholar, and hence it has been A class. We have seen how our reality of nature into visually appealing paintings. We have not moved, sir. We have all, I'm sure all of us have stuck to the seat and listening, and it was both a visual and a audio delight too. He has cleared many misunderstandings and placed matters in the right perspective, starting from the effect of art, purpose of art, the distinction into 2D, 3D of Chitra, Chitrardha and Chitrabhasa, of sculpture, relief and painting, the importance of painting in homes, the various bases, the beauty of Hoysala art on the Bhuvaneshwariya, the ceilings of the temples, how it got converted to painting during the Vijayanagara period. And also geographically, he has spoken about how the migration of artists took place, what was Mysore kingdom earlier, and what is Mysore now, and what happened at the fall of the Vijayanagara empire. And he is one of the very few scholars who unhesitatingly made mention of pre-Tipu, during Tipu, and post-Tipu period, because which is the Mumadi period, because Tipu is a taboo in our many circles, both in Bangalore as well as in Karnataka. But you have very boldly made this distinction as to how the painting evolved, and just from painting, from simple painting, with the outlines, how the outline is very important, and then to embossing with the gold. Thank you so much, Dr. Nagara Sharma. I'm very privileged that you made this. I know it is an extraordinary effort. How much of preparation has gone into this? Because it is not easy to bring music and to bring a sound and the talk and all into it. It was just like a movie. I was sitting in a movie theater. It looked like that. It was a wonderful, wonderful 1 hour session. And I thank my ladies and gentlemen, the audience, for patiently listening through, sitting through, and not moving away and thinking God knows when it will come. But we were very fortunate and we continued the program. So thank you. Because we have overshot our time, I will just read out the appreciation coming your way, from which encapsulates the entire feeling of the listeners here. Dr. Ravishankar Srinivasan, who says, Dr. Sharma's narration is so lucid and he lends lot of clarity to his explanation, lacing with lots of Sanskrit texts. I think that is the bonus. It touches at once the heart of the listener and it is a feast to the eyes of the connoisseur of art. Then we have Vukkem Satyanarayana Murthy who says, the presentation of Dr. Sharma is excellent, explaining the base and the importance of paintings. Indeed, a feast to the eyes, viewing the beautiful paintings and enjoyed the Sanskrit slokas in his talk. So on this note, we once again thank you for your excellent and lucid presentation, which has really made this talk very interesting. So thank you so, so much, Mr. Dr. Nagaraj Sharma. I am very much indebted with the time you have taken and for coming on to our platform.